Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship service this morning. And we give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area, or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. Again, the entire service is in your bulletin, except for the last two hymns. The opening hymn is inserted in your bulletin, and then all the rest of the liturgy and so forth is in your bulletin. You need the hymn, not only for the very last hymn, the recessional hymn. So we begin on page 2 with the order of confession and forgiveness. And I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and make us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Let us now begin our worship with the inserted hymn, Must Jesus Bear the Cross Alone, inserted in your bulletin.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. I'm your announcer, Dr. Sally Abbott. Your videographer is Linda Fox. And assistant is James Pompousius. We're happy to bring you our service today. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. Rejoice and thank God that he has made this day for us, and we are using it according to his will. We're singing now a gospel song. Every Sunday we're singing a gospel song. And this is Must Jesus Bear the Cross Alone, in theme with Lent. Must Jesus Bear the Cross Alone, written by Thomas Shepard, an American songwriter. Gospel hymn, Must Jesus Bear the Cross Alone.
Thank you.
of all through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
You may be seated as we listen to the reading.
Gina Pollock will do the first reading. We'll do the song. Pastor Pollock, our pastor, will be reading the gospel. I want to thank Gina Pollock for reading the scriptures and Mickey Dimitrov for leading us in the song. We're now singing Lenten Acclamation. It's the fifth Sunday of Lent, and we are in the midst of Lent. Holy Week will be with us soon.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 12th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept a common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you quickly. First of all, this Wednesday, we have our final midweek Lent services at 2 o'clock in the chapel and then 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. This also will be the last midweek supper. And so please join us either at 2 or at 7 or 5:30 to eat. The parable will be the parable of the two sons in Matthew 21. And so that will bring our examination of the parables to a close. And of course, Sunday, a week from today, is Palm Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week. Of course, with Holy Week, that means services on Thursday and Friday of Holy Week, Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, 2 and 7 o'clock for those. Also, I hope as you came in and you picked up, we're doing something new today. This 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper, if you didn't, maybe raise your hand and an usher can bring you one. This is something that our middle son, the church he goes to, does, and a lot of churches today are going to, as I listen to other churches on the internet and TV, and that is sermon notes. And the purpose of this is for you to be able to listen to the sermon and fill in the blanks, and then later in the week you can reread the passage, sermon text, and go over what the lesson was contained in that text. The one disadvantage we have is we don't have a screen like our middle son's church has, where they fill in the blanks as the pastor is going along. But I assure you this follows the way the notes will go. To give you an idea of what we're doing, I'm going to answer a couple of them for you. So the first one, where do we discover what loving Jesus actually involves? That, of course, is the gospel. So the first question is the gospel. You'll hear me say that when the sermon begins. The first step in loving Jesus is to understand who Jesus is. Again, I'll be repeating these, but I'm just giving you an idea of how they are. Drop down to the bottom. The second step in loving Jesus is to give him our best. And the third step in loving Jesus is to come to him in humility. So there you have a head start. Now I'll leave it up to you during the sermon to be able to catch the rest of the answers. And as I said, take it home, use it for your own study then throughout the week. And now I ask that you give your attention to our call.
Special music by our chancel choir, directed by Vicki Perks. It's in keeping with the season of Lent. This is March 13th, 2016, the fifth Sunday of Lent.
Thank you.
love Jesus. In the time when there's a Sunday school or vacation Bible school for the first time, we learn songs about loving Jesus and how Jesus loves us. When I was serving Hopeful Church in Florence, Kentucky, we had an old gospel hymn that congregation liked to sing, not in church so much, because our organist and choir director had studied at the Lutheran Institute of Music in Berlin, and if a song didn't have a strong Lutheran heritage to it, he wouldn't play it. So we sang it like at potlucks and other informal gatherings, but the chorus of it was, "Oh, how I love Jesus, oh, how I love Jesus, oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me." And that is what we have to remember, is Jesus loved us first. Jesus loves us so much that he came down to earth to save us from sin, death, and the power of the devil. So when we say we love Jesus, we are just responding to that love that he has first given us. And when we say we love Jesus, do we know what that entails? If we're not sure what it entails to love Jesus, we go to the gospel. Because it is in the gospel that we have illustrated for us what it means to truly love Jesus. And so we turn to that 12th chapter, the Gospel of St. John, this morning, to once again recall that event where Jesus comes to the house of Lazarus in the chapter before he raised from the dead. And he's having a meal with Mary and Martha. And Mary, while they are eating, takes some expensive perfume and anoints Jesus' feet with it and dries it with her hair. And then, of course, Judas has to pop up and say how it should have been sold for money and they could have given it to the poor, when the reality is that Judas wanted it so he could put it in a money bag that he kept for the disciples and take it some out every now and then without anybody knowing. So this event demonstrates to us the three steps needed to show you love Jesus, to respond to that love that Jesus has first given you. And as I said already, that first step is to understand who Jesus is. Now, this might seem like a pretty simple statement, but you would be surprised at how many people do not understand who Jesus is. We first go to the gospel level. As we read the Gospels, whether it's Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, we are amazed. Of course, we're looking at it from beyond the activity, so we know what happened, so that prejudices our outlook a little bit. But we're still amazed at how the disciples, who travel with Jesus every day, who see Jesus doing all these wonderful things, still don't understand who Jesus is. They have an idea he's a Messiah, but they don't have the right idea of what the Messiah is. They're looking for a warrior king, not the suffering servant of Isaiah. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, the scribes, the rabbis, the teachers of the law, the people who should have known the scriptures and known what the Messiah would be and how he would be on earth and how he would act and what he would do, they didn't understand Jesus. They fought him tooth and nail every step of the way, constantly trying to throw up roadblocks to his ministry, constantly trying to trap him, constantly trying to say that he was a blasphemer and a false prophet. And then you have people today who look at Jesus and they don't understand who he is. But Mary, the mother of a sister of Martha, the sister of Lazarus, from her gospel account, she seems to be the one that understands who Jesus is. And she anoints his feet with that perfume, and Jesus said she has bought it for his burial. So it indicates that Mary understood that Jesus was going to have to suffer and die for the salvation of the world. He had been telling everyone that. He had been telling the disciples that he would be handed over to evil men, that he would suffer, that he would die, and on the third day rise. But nobody seemed to be paying attention, except for Mary. as she anoints his feet with his perfume that evidently was a type also used for the anointing of dead bodies, she does this out of a sense of love and respect for Jesus, realizing what lies ahead for Jesus. There's so many others. Even within the walls of the church, so many people today think of Jesus as just another teacher, just another philosopher, just another prophet like a whole line of prophets, just another holy man. But they don't look at him as a sacred work. They don't recognize that that death upon the cross was not simply a miscarriage of Roman justice, an innocent man being condemned to death, but that it was a willing sacrifice by Jesus Christ himself to pay that horrible debt of sin that we owe. That it was Jesus' willingness to go to that cross, to bear upon that cross all the sins of the world, and to pay in full that debt to God. The people who do not look at Jesus as Savior do not understand what his atoning death was all about, fail to understand the workings of God in the Old Testament. For in the Old Testament, God makes it clear that he is sending one who will crush the devil's head, just as he had promised Adam and Eve before he threw them out of the garden. That he would send this Messiah, this anointed one, who would come to free his people from sin, death, and the devil, as the prophets had foretold. A holy God must have satisfaction for the sins that are committed. A holy God cannot stand in the presence of sin, no matter how small. A holy God cannot wink at sin and turn his back on it, but there must be satisfaction. Under the old covenant, that satisfaction was made with the slaughtering of bulls and goats and birds and other forms of sacrifice. But that still cannot pay the enormous debt of sin that we as human beings rack up before God. And so as St. Paul explains to us in Romans 5, 12 to 21, as sin entered the world through one man, Adam, with his rebellion in the garden, so now salvation enters the world through one man, Jesus Christ, the Savior. If then, if you truly love Jesus, then you understand that he is indeed the Lord and Savior of the world. That he is indeed the way, the truth, and the life. And that no one can come to the Father except through him. That is what it means to love Jesus. You understand why he came into this world. You understand his mission. You understand that sacrifice upon the cross. You understand that that pays the debt of sin that you owe. You understand that you can do nothing to earn salvation, but throw yourself upon the mercy and grace of God through that faith in Jesus Christ, that Jesus has done it all and God has done it all out of their love for us. So we love as a response in return, and that first step is to understand who Jesus. The second step is that we give Jesus our best. Mary anoints Jesus with a very expensive perfume. Now, from what Jesus says, evidently Mary, as I said, understood his mission, and so she had bought it for his upcoming burial. She may have bought it for some other reasons, we don't know, but it was very expensive, it was top of the line, and that is what she gave Jesus. She didn't sit back and say, oh, well, I got this cheap off-brand stuff at Walgreens that smells kind of like the real stuff, and I'll just put that on Jesus' feet. She used the real thing. And I used to have a cologne that I really liked, but when you went to all those stores in the mall that aren't there anymore, you know, it was $50, $60, $70 if you wanted to spray. I'd go to Walgreens and get this, and it almost smelled exactly the same, at $9.99. Well, that's not giving your best, that's giving your cheapest. Mary didn't do that. She went to Macy's or Evergreen or Penny's, and she paid the $80 for the best, not the $9.99 for the cheapest. So we are to give Jesus our best. We don't give him the leftovers. We don't give him the hand-me-downs. We don't give him what time, talent, and treasure we have left after we've done everything we wanted to do. And say, here, Jesus, be satisfied with this. When we love Jesus, we always give him the best. Remember when Jesus was sitting in the temple and he was watching the people put in their offerings after a service, and evidently in the temple there were these large bronze horns that had slits in them that people put their offerings in. Of course, being their money was all coins, you could hear them rattle down, so a rich person would come up and put a bunch of coins in. You'd hear all those coins bang down the tube to the bottom. Well, then suddenly came an older lady, a widow, and she put in what today would be 2 cents. And remember what Jesus said. That widow had given more than all those rich people and all their wealth, because they were just giving a percentage. They could have given a higher percentage. They were just giving what they could get by with. This woman gave everything she had as a response to the love of God. She was not worrying about where her next meal was coming from. She wasn't going to worry about where and how she was going to get food. She wanted to give to God the best she had, and that was 2 cents. As followers of Jesus Christ who say we love Jesus, that is what we're to do. We are to give Jesus our best. To give him the best of whatever we have, of our time, talent, and treasure. And to give it to him before we spend our money on our hobbies and our wants and our what we think are necessities, what we think are luxuries. We give to Jesus before that. Hallmark card advertises, when you think the most to give, to send the very best. Be careful to send the very best. Saying that they're the fanciest card to send to somebody. Well, God cared enough to send the very best. His son, Jesus Christ. He had sent prophets in the Old Testament days. He had sent anointed kings, David and Solomon. Then he had, when the time was right, he sent the very best there was. We are to respond to that gracious action of God by giving him our very best. There was a pastor who had 3 sons. And the first 2 sons were close together and went through school, and they were all conference this and all conference that. Academic this, academic that. Then there was the third son who was some years younger, and the pastor worried about how he was going to make it in life because of the identity of his brothers and how it might be difficult for him going through school, because he was more reserved than his brothers. He wasn't as outgoing. He wasn't as athletically gifted. He wasn't quite as academically gifted. It wasn't that he wasn't smart, but he just wasn't quite, his IQ wasn't quite as high as his brothers, and so he had to study hard to make A's, where his 2 brothers before him pretty much just opened a book, closed it, and got an A. So in order to give this son an identity, the pastor would take him fishing, hunting, and camping, and taught him all there was to know about fishing, hunting, and camping. Now the other 2 boys would go along too, but most of the effort and so forth was spent on the younger son. And the one thing the pastor says, that, and those of you who are involved in these things probably know this, he said that if you're involved in hunting, camping, or fishing, I know from fishing, that the one thing you always need is a good knife. If you don't have a good knife, you try to hunt, fish, or camp, you end up in all kinds of difficulties, because there's always something that needs to be cut, or widow or something, in order to pitch a tent, clean up an animal you shot, or gut a fish, cut a fishing line, whatever. So the youngest son was known as the knife, because he had this pocket knife he always carried with him, and it was always there when they needed something to be done with a knife in camping, hunting, or fishing. He was it. He always had it. and that knife was his most prized possession. A couple years later, there was going to be a birthday party at the home for the pastor. Several hours before the party, he was in his study in his home, and he didn't hear his youngest son come in, but after a few minutes, he felt his presence, and he turned around, and he said, "Well, hi, son." He said, "What you need?" And his son said, "Dad, I wanted to give you a birthday present before the party started, and give it to you just in the privacy between you and me." And so his dad said, "Okay," and his son handed him this box that was all wrapped up, had a ribbon on the lid. Father undid it. When he opened the lid, there was a boy's pocket knife. It was his way of giving to his dad his very best. That was what was most dear to him. And he wanted to return his father's love by giving his father that most prized possession. God sent us the very best. We are to give our very best to his son in service to him, and not waste our time on the things of the world, which, as Jesus tells us, moth and rust destroy, and thieves break in. And then the third step is that we come to Jesus in humility. As Jesus himself said, the Son of Man came to the world not to be served, but to serve. And as his followers, we are given that those same instructions. That we, as his followers, come to serve the world, not to be served by it. Mary comes to Jesus and performs one of the most humiliating tasks one could do in the ancient world. You've heard me talk about it before, especially around Maundy Thursday. To wash someone's feet, to wash a guest's feet, was a task given to the lowest slave in the household. If the household had no slaves, then it was the duty of the youngest child. So here Mary comes to Jesus, anoints his feet with this oil or this perfume, and wipes his feet clean with her hair. Coming to Jesus in humility. And that is, if we love Jesus, that is how we come in. We don't come in arrogance. We don't come thumping our chest, bragging about all the Bible verses we know, or all the retreats we've been on, or all the this or that we've done for the glory of God. To our Lord Jesus Christ. Mary was not ashamed to act in such a humble fashion for our Lord due to her great love for him, and we should not be embarrassed to do likewise. She gave totally to Jesus out of her love for him. Jesus calls us to love him in the same way. If we love Jesus, we should be willing to do no matter what he asks, even something we never would think of, something we never thought possible of doing, something we never dreamed of doing, we do it because he did it first. As St. Paul reminds us in Philippians 2, verses 7 and 8, this is the answer to one of your questions there, but that's the last one. He reminds us what all Jesus gave up in order to be the Savior of the world. Speaking of Jesus, he said, "But he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant." That's the first part. He emptied himself. He took the form of a servant, born in the likeness of people, humanity. Being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So that's the answer to Philippians 2, 7 and 8, what Jesus did. He emptied himself. He emptied himself of all the power and majesty of heaven. He emptied himself from sitting at the right hand of the Father and being worshipped by the seraphim and cherubim and all the angels and archangels, by all the martyrs and followers who are there. He emptied himself of all that glory to come down and be born in a stable, to become an adult, so that he willingly would sacrifice himself for us. He took the form of a servant. He was born like God as a human being. He humbled himself and he became obedient. obedient to giving his life on the cross for all. Loving Jesus means a willingness to humble oneself for the good of the Lord and for his church. It's easy to say, and it's easy to sing, "Oh, how I love Jesus." To put it into action is a totally different matter. To show you truly love Jesus, you have to understand who he is and not be ashamed to proclaim it. When someone tries to argue with you that he's just a prophet like Moses or Samuel or Jonah or Isaiah, Jeremiah or Muhammad, say, "No, I understand who Jesus really is. He's the Savior of the world. He's the Son of God. He's the Son of Man. He is truly divine, truly human. He paid the debt of sin so that we might have victory over sin, death, and the power of death. If you truly love Jesus, you will give him your best. Not give him seconds or thirds or lasts." Remember the story of Cain and Abel? God wouldn't accept Cain's offering because he would give God his rotten fruit, the last bit of his harvest, where Abel would give him the best sheep out of the flock. We are to give Jesus our best. And if we love Jesus, we will come to him humbly. And we will be willing to serve him wherever he calls us to serve, whether it is to serve him in a easy place or a difficult place. Whether it's to serve him where Christians are the majority, or serve him where Christians are the minority and persecuted. When we love Jesus, we go wherever he calls us. So if we really understand Jesus, if we give him our best, if we come to him in humility and be humble, then we truly show how we love Jesus. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds to Christ Jesus. Amen.
The
Lord
be with us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, your help in our daily walk with you. May the stations of the cross give us time to pause and reflect on your great love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we ask that you be with those who are in any sort of need or distress. Help us reach out to them in their time of trouble. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, in this time of giving more of ourselves, may we realize what talents you have given us so that we might use our time and treasures accordingly. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, as we give of ourselves, help us also learn from others so that we might see more opportunities to be like you. Open our hearts and eyes to the things we can do to walk in your path. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we ask that you be with us all, especially pray for those who are traveling, are sick, abused, or shut in. Fill with joy those who celebrate birthdays and anniversaries. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, we commend all things to you, trusting in your mercy for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Time for our offering. Nelson and Linda Smith are ushers. The offering is received as the Lord's table is prepared. We have confessed our sins, we've repented, we've made our profession of faith. We're born again every day as we invite Jesus to come into our heart. We love Jesus. We invite him to come Savior and Lord of our lives. We ask you to come worship with us, to repent, to believe, to make your confession of faith, to be born again every day just as we are. And we walk with the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the fourth Sunday of Lent, March the 13th, 2016. We are happy to have you worshiping with us today through YouTube. We'd like to have you here with some of the best people in Clark County who are worshiping and who work to feed the homeless, to take care of the needy, to do God's will. As we're born again, we love Jesus. We receive his love, and we go out to spread his love to others. We thank you for listening. We thank you for watching us. We thank you for your prayers. We will pray for you. We ask for God to bless you. Jesus loves us because he first loved us. We accept his love. We do his will. We go out and serve others. Now the ushers are coming forward to receive the offering. The offering is received, the Lord's table is prepared. Jesus is with us. Those who have gone before us are with us. The angels, the archangels are with us. We're all here worshiping together, and someday we'll be in heaven together. As we are born again, we are raising our gifts to God. We're praying to God. God is here with us. He is taking these gifts up to heaven, bringing them down to us, and receiving again the body and blood of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare a joy for the Paschal feast that renewed in the gift of baptism. We may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels from the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated.
now received the true body of Christ, the bread from heaven, brought down from heaven, the blood of Christ. We're reconciled to God. We're all part of one another. We're all part of Jesus Christ. All those who have gone before us, all those who will come after us, we're all one, be together someday in heaven. We thank God for reconciling us through Jesus Christ and his cross, as he died on the cross to save us from sins. We're thankful for that. Jesus is the Lord of our lives. We receive his blood, we receive his body, we become part of him. We are thankful that he gave the sacrifice for us. He loves us so much, and we love him for it. I Survey the Wondrous Cross is one of the finest hymns in the English language. It was the favorite hymn of Charles Wesley. It was written by Isaac Watts, the father of English hymnology, a pastor in the Anglican Church in England. It was written in 1707. Beautiful hymn. His brother talked him into writing it down, having it published, or we would never have it. Sing this hymn, finest hymn in the English language, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Thank you.
playing Oh How I Love Jesus Because He First Loved Me. That was the theme today. Jesus loves us. He's given Himself for us on the cross. We're now a part of Him. We're filled with His love. We'll be with Him forever. Thank you for watching St. John's on YouTube. Tune in anytime. We're happy to bring you this broadcast. Our church offers a Christian school program for ages 3 and 4, a nursery and pre-K. Please let the children know this. We want children to know the love of Jesus. We're born again here every day. As we repent, we confess, we receive the Lord, bread of heaven, come down from heaven. As God has given His Son, He sent His angels up to receive the bread from heaven to give us the peace of heaven. I hope and I pray that God will bless you this Lord's Day.